This is my old MacBook Pro, and this guy right here has been through a lot with me in the past 5 years. It is a 2017 model with Intel Core i7 quad core 7th generation, 16 gigs of RAM, 256 of storage, and a Radeon Pro Vega 2 gigs of VRAM. And yeah, it's not the best, not the worst, but it handled my workload very, very well. Endless hours of music production, video editing, photos edited in both Photoshop and Lightroom, even some graphic design, like some of the graphics that you see on our videos, or for example, the logo of the Talent Universe that's made by me on this guide right here on Illustrator. And I've done some gaming as well, because I like to play Dota 2, and this laptop was running it, at least in the first 2 years, at the highest settings without any fuss. At least 60, 70, or even 100 frames per second. So yeah, it was doing a great job. It's still doing a decent job, especially considering its age, but I believe that time has left its own stamp on it, and it's time for an upgrade. And I can't believe that I'm saying that I'm upgrading from a MacBook Pro to a Mac Mini. Let's begin. Okay, so this is the Mac Mini that I got. This is the base M2 version with 8 gigs of RAM and 256 gigs of storage. I still hate you, Apple, for your storage prices. However, I found an offer on Black Friday and I got it for just around $600. And you might say that this is the starting price. And yes, you are right, this is the starting price, but in the United States. I'm from Romania, Europe, and when it gets here, the prices can go up to even $850 due to taxes, transport, and everything. So I saw it and I said, yes, I have to get it because I need it. And so did I. And I'm quite excited, I cannot lie. I'm a big fan of Apple Silicon, and I know that their ARM processors are very good, and I know that ARM processors are the next big thing, especially for the consumer part. And I have my doubts about it, obviously. I know that the solution comes with its own disadvantages, like the fact that you cannot upgrade it the way you buy it. That's how you'll have it forever. And obviously, I have a big doubt about the way it can be repaired, because the CPU, the GPU, the RAM, and the storage, they're all stuck together into one single piece. But this is actually its main advantage, if you like. The speed and the bandwidth that these parts are communicating between them, it's insane. And this is actually what makes it so good, with the specs being so low. 8 gigs of RAM on this machine will behave so much better than the 16 gigs that I have on my MacBook. But yeah, we'll see how it goes in time. If you want to know more about the ARM technology, just leave a comment down below and I will make a separate video on it, because Apple did not have the first try. They just had the first good try. So yeah, there's some history in there. But for now, let's just concentrate on what we've got. The Mac Mini M2. So this is just an overview, a first impression if you like. I didn't have a lot of time to spend on testing it. I'm still transferring stuff from my old machine to this one. We will go through the unboxing, setup experience, and then we will do some testing as well. We will do some video editing in DaVinci Resolve, 4K XAVCS from my Sony A7 III, and then we will do Studio One as well. Recording in 32 bits, 48,000 Hertz, and then applying effects, exporting, rendering, and everything. So yeah, let's see how it does. So as I said, this is the base version, 8-core CPU, 10-core GPU, 8 gigs of RAM, and 256 gigs of storage, which I believe is shameful. Shame on you, Apple. The unboxing is quite Apple, may I say. You get a big white box, which opens fairly easy. You open it, and then you can see the Mac Mini. Underneath it, you'll have some paperwork, one sticker, and a charger, and that's it. No, I swear, like 60 or maybe even 70% of the package is the box. The rest of it is the content. So talking about ecology here. The setup though was quite easy. So first things first, you get a fair amount of ports. So you have two USB-A, two Thunderbolt 4 ports, a jack 3.5 millimeter port. You get an Ethernet port as well, and an HDMI, which I believe is a 2.0. Yeah, nothing to foresee. The only thing that personally I would have liked to have on it is a card reader, but at the same time I have a dongle, which I was using on my MacBook, dongle which has an extra HDMI port, so I was able to connect two monitors to it. So that's fine. Yeah, it's enough. Yeah, and also you have the Thunderbolt 4 ports, which are very fast. And I believe that the Ethernet port supports up to 10 gigs per second in terms of speed. So fair enough, Apple. That's good. Now, the first thing that comes up when you turn on the device is like a classic hello screen, the one that you get on phones as well. I like the fact that it has, and it's been the case with the Macs all the time, so you get the operating system pre-installed, so the setting up was really easy, straightforward. Log in with your Apple ID, and then if you want to back up from an old device, you can use the Time Machine. I didn't use it at that time, but I can still use it now from the system preferences, so thumbs up for that. I always liked how easy it is to set up an Apple device. For example, my phone, I have an iPhone 13, and before that, I have an iPhone XS. And when I got the 13, I turned it on, and while I was setting it up, at some point it brings up, it pops up something in which it says, if you want to back up from a device, it's time to do it now. So all I had to do is just to take the XS, put it next to the 13, and it was just copying everything from the old phone to the new one. The only thing, if I remember correctly, that I had to set up manually afterwards was stuff like the bank accounts, the banking applications, and that's fair enough. That's sensible, really sensible information. So yeah, 10 out of 10. Apple always has put a lot of effort into the user experience, and they're getting away with it. Fair play, what can I say? And now we get to the interesting part, which is the testing. So first things first, like casual browsing into Safari or Brave or Chrome or whatever browser you're using, and into the Mac OS in terms of like opening applications and the Finder and everything, that's good. I mean, there's not that big of a difference between the Mac Mini and the MacBook Pro, because those are easy tasks for a decent processor and some good RAM memory. Things are getting interesting when we look at the editing part. So I've downloaded DaVinci Resolve, the free version, and Studio One Artist 5, things that I'm using on a daily basis for all of my production stuff. So the first thing that I started to edit was the last reel or TikTok that we have posted, which I recommend you to go and have a look for. It's really nice. 4K XAVCS from Sony A7 III. This is a really hard format for pretty much every machinery or software, to be fair, and my MacBook was really struggling with it. Now, the first thing that I've tried to do was to edit with the media coming from an external HDD, which is quite slow, and I wasn't expecting that much of a difference, and indeed it was slow, but that's because it was an HDD, so the hard drive was slow itself, and obviously probably the Mac in this solution with the ARM architecture wouldn't really get along well with something which is coming from outside, especially when we talk about an HDD and not even an SSD. So what I've done, I filmed the reel, and then I've imported everything into the Mac and I've started to edit. The first impression was like, meh, it wasn't that big of a difference at the beginning, but then starting to add up things, it was fine. It was smooth enough. I wasn't using any proxy or anything, and it was moving quite well, may I say. To be fair though, the playback wasn't the smoothest ever. I guess it's because of the format of the video. As I said, XAVCS is not the best when it comes to that, but at the same time, you have to bear in mind that there are a lot of people out there who are using Sonys. So yeah, not everyone is shooting in ProRes, so you need to have something to deal well with everything. Obviously, Apple would probably tell you, oh, but you have to get an M2 Max or an M2 Ultra or at least an M2 Pro. No, I'm sorry, I'm not doing that. Bye. I don't remember the render time exactly, but it took it around 3 minutes or something like that to render 42 seconds of 4K XAVC in 9x16 format, which is decent, I guess, considering that I had color correction and then colorization on the same clip, plus some overlay videos, and then I had the sound as well, which I had to modify a bit, just a bit. So it did a decent job, I can't really complain about it. I'm still waiting to see how it will handle a big YouTube project, like something like a 10 or 15 minutes video. That would be interesting, because I had some stuff before on the MacBook which were impossible for me to see in the timeline. I literally had to export the video so I can see if they look good or not. So yeah, we'll see how it handles that as well. And now let's jump to Studio One. So what I've done, I've recorded the audio for the last reel using this Yeti Blue microphone. And this microphone is connected through a dongle because I don't have enough USB-A ports. So this one is in a dongle. The latency, zero. I mean, not zero, something like 3.8 milliseconds, but decent enough to record anything, especially at this high bitrate. I haven't even used my audio interface. I've recorded in 32 bits float and 48 kilohertz. The result? Oh well. I'm not sure if Studio One is fully compatible with the ARM architecture or if it's running through Rosetta, but goddamn, I don't even care. It went perfectly. Don't get me wrong, it was just one audio track which was loaded with 6 plugins and 2 FX channels, one for the reverb, one for the delay, and each FX channel having 3 or 4 plugins on it as well. So the workload wasn't that bad, right? But to have that with the CPU at 1% all the time, that's good. Obviously, I will record an album on this Mac Mini, so we will see then how it handles big projects with tens of tracks and tens of plugins, including Auto-Tune, Melodyne, and things that are eating resources, basically. But it looks very, very promising for now. The export was under 2 seconds for 42 seconds of audio. Great, I love it. So yeah, for me, the first impression is that I still have mixed feelings about it, but that's probably because I didn't have enough time to explore it properly. So for now, I will just sit down and say, yeah, it's good, I like it. I think I will do my job better than I was doing it on my MacBook Pro, but only the time will tell. $600 for a machine that can edit 4K 30 frames per second in XAVCS. That's good. That's pretty good. Yeah, it may not be the smoothest experience or the fastest experience, if you like. It may not be the fastest render out there, but still you can do the job with it. And this is what matters the most, essentially. Now, I want to know your opinion on it. What do you think about the ARM architecture? And what do you think about this Mac Mini? Do you think it's a good buy, especially at this price point? Or do you think that there are better options in the market? And that's it for this video. I hope you liked it. I hope you found it useful. It's our first ever review and we plan to do even more in the future. Meanwhile, we want to know your feedback. Leave it down below in the comments. Let us know what can we improve to make this kind of videos better. And until the next time, take care of yourself. Bye bye.